सो हेलो एवरीवन, सो लेट्स कंटिन्यू अवर सब्जेक्ट डेटाबेस एंड वी वर ऑन ट्रांजैक्शंस एंड कॉन्करेंसी कंट्रोल सिंस दिस इज अनदर एसिंक्रोनस मीटिंग. सो वी विल डू अ फ्यू स्मॉल टॉपिक्स इन दिस सेशन एंड विल कंटिन्यू अवर प्रीवियस सेशन. So in the previous class, we have seen about classification of schedules based on recoverability. Then we saw the classification of schedules based on serializability as well, both of the conditions. And also we have gone through a few good questions as well. So our today's topic will be concurrency control techniques. We are in the last phase of our transactions and concurrency control. So we have seen a lot of things about transactions, starting from its acid properties. Then we saw the concurrency advantages. What are the problems that we face because of concurrency? Then we understood the solution for those problems and we categorized to find out the serial schedule for the possible parallel schedules with the help of two techniques, that is your conflict serializability and then view serializability. We understood, we generally try to avoid view serializability. The reason behind was it's an NPC, NP complete problem. That time complexity to find out the solution is an exponential. And for order of n square, within that you can find out conflict serializability. That's the conflict schedule, conflict equal schedules in that way. Also, we understood about recoverability, how we can perform the recoverability among the schedules and a lot of other things. Now let's see what the concurrency control techniques that we have. But to understand this concurrency control technique, we have to understand why we use, what's the use of these techniques in our database. Before that, let's see, go back and we'll see what we have done in a broad way. If you talk about, for example, so far we have seen the transaction properties, right? Their schedule, maintenance, consistency in database, conflict serializability and view serializability are everything. Means we were given a transaction. Means given is schedule and we need to check all those things, conflicts equal or view equal or not, everything that we need to check. The thing is we were given those schedule, right? And we have performed a lot of operations, for example, and we have find out, we reached to some conclusion. But now, remember, when we talk about concurrency control techniques, now we will read or we will study a set of protocols, as a rules are there, right? That guarantee to generate the schedules, right? So now in the concurrency control technique, we will understand what are the protocols that actually generate the schedules. And how we will generate the schedule, the schedules that will follow the certain protocols, and those include some properties like the schedule must be conflict serializable, for example, right? Why we need to keep our database consistent. So in a way, the thing is in concurrency control technique, we will understand those set of protocols, right? With the help of which we will generate only those schedules which will keep our database consistent. Understand? So we broadly talk about specific conflict serializability, right? So we have seen the conflict serializability is the practical one approach that we follow to find the serial schedule. So understand here, going back to the topics that we have covered, the conflicting operations, we need to take care of conflicting operations here as well. Right, focus on that. So what are the conflicting operations or say the instructions that we have? For example, with read, we have write operations. With write, we have read and then write and write. Right, on the same data item, but different transaction, at least one write is your conflicting pair. We have seen this, right, in a very good way. So we need to again take care of these things when we generate some schedule using set of protocol. Remember one thing, again, very important. See, for example, we have one data item A, right? There are two transactions, TI and TJ. These transactions want to perform some operation over this data item. Let's say T1 wants to read and TJ wants to write. TI wants to read and TJ wants to write. See, the thing is, we cannot restrict any transaction to perform some operation on the database. Right? Then what the problem? The problem is both of the transactions are performing the operation at same point of time. This is our reason, right? This is the problem that we face, right? We cannot restrict any transaction to perform any operation over the data item. The problem is they are doing that at the same point of time. And that's what, if we are possible, right? If it is possible for us to anyhow manage this time, right? If TI perform read operation first and then TJ perform the write operation, or we say TJ, let's say perform write operation first and TI perform the read operation. If anyhow we manage this time, then there will be no issue, right? So the thing comes here is how we can manage this time among the transaction, right? So this is what we are going to go through in our concurrency control techniques, right? So both of them we have seen are performing the action at the same time. So to manage this time, say the protocol list that we have to manage this conflict that we arise at the execution at the same time. These protocol lists are as follows, and which we will understand in this. This is a kind of technique that we follow to avoid this conflict. The first protocol says is your timestamp based protocol. Second, your log based protocol, log. So in basically in log based, we'll see 2PL, that is two phase log. And we'll also see the graph approach also, how we can use the graph. And the third, we will see about the validation based protocol. Let me give a brief idea on this one, how the things work in this protocol, and we'll see in depth each and every protocol here. First is your timestamp protocol. So understand, as the name says, so what actually will happen in this one is, for example, we have two different transactions, TI and TJ, and they want to perform some operation over your database. So what actually we will do is, whenever your transaction will enter into your system, we will actually provide a timestamp. Some values will be given to those transaction, right? So whenever first transaction will enter into your system, we will give some value. For example, we'll understand what that value is. When the second transaction will enter into the system, some ordering will be done, right? So the different value will be given to the second transaction. So this approach will be used to avoid the conflict between the transaction. Means what? Whenever we will say that whenever first transaction enters into the system, we'll get out of the system first. We'll be given priority, a kind of right, on the top of your second transaction that entered late into the system. So some timestamp technique is being used in this protocol, in this technique over here. Right. So basically the main idea is we provide a number, that's a unique number, say the time itself, we will see what's that, right? And with the help of which we'll order the transaction, and that ordering will be actually a serial schedule, right? So in depth, we'll see that. So this is the basic approach we follow in the timestamp. The second is your log-based protocol. So what actually happens here is, for example, see what log-based protocol says, you want to use some data item, for example, right? You want to perform read and write operation over the data item. Log-based protocol says that, okay, fine. So you do one thing, you lock the data item first and you apply the operation. Once it is done, you unlock, right? And you unlock, and then other transaction probably maybe might now access your data item. They will again lock and they will unlock once operations are done. So this is a log-based technique, and actually log-based technique provide you the isolation, because when you log something, then definitely only you have the access to modify or say changes in that one, right? So again, there is a smart way we need to apply log. We will see a lot of, you know, I mean, for example, we have some issue when we apply the log-based techniques and how we resolve those issues. So in depth, we'll see that and we'll cover the log-based protocol. Then the third one is basically a validation based protocol, right? So what actually happened, understand, if you talk about a real life scenario, for example, we want to book some flight, right? So what happens in a day, for example, the viewers or say the users and user, they used to visit the website, right? And what actually happens, out of let's say 50 users, those who visited the website, hardly and say probably out of those 50, two or three have made the real transaction. They just went to the last step, performed the transaction, and booked the flight. Means there is a very less number of read operations, actually we can say, done over the database, but a very less write operation, lot of read operations, right? So validation based protocol works in a, it's a kind of opposite way, right? In a reverse fashion. For example, once what it will do is it will consider that initially all other read operations are being performed. And then when the write operation is performed, it will go back and will validate whether the transaction performed is a valid or not. So in that we will understand in depth what actually this is the kind of approach being followed in validation based protocol, right? So, okay, fine. We will see now one by one in depth, and this video will be probably focused more on everything on your time-based protocol, timestamp-based protocol, right? Okay. So let's start. The first is your timestamp-based protocol. Okay, so what, as I just told you, in timestamp-based protocol, when multiple transactions enter into a system, right? So we need to decide the transaction or say the order sequence before entering into the database system, right? So once it enters into the system, it will execute in the fashion, the way, or say the sequence that has been assigned to this transaction, right? So this is the one approach that is being followed in timestamp based protocol to avoid a conflict. That's what using your ordering. So whenever a transaction enters, it is provided some value. Now understand one thing. As the name says, it's a timestamp. So we know that every time is a unique. For example, 1 second that is just passed right now will not come back, will not repeat here, right? The same approach is being followed in this one. The timestamp means whenever a transaction enters, about to enter into the system, the value that we provide is actually the time itself, right? So the time, or say the time, is being provided as a value, and when it will enter into the system, throughout the system, execution of this transaction, the value will remain the same, right? So we can use the time itself as a stamp. And how? That's what a system clock value, right? So with the help of the system clock value, we are going to provide this value as a stamp to your transaction. It will always be unique and will never repeat, right? So we have understood. Now when we provide this value to the transaction, the execution is what the important part plays the role over here, right? But before that, let's understand when we provide the timestamp values, there are different ways in which we provide this timestamp. Remember, the first is we provide the timestamp to the transaction, right? Timestamp to transactions. So what it means, each transaction, let's say there is a transaction TI, some each transaction we associate a timestamp value, right? And how we denote that, that is TS, T of I. It means what? This T of I is given some timestamp value T of S, for example, say. Right. So it is a value of the system clock given when the transaction enters into your system. Right. Now understand one thing. Let's say there is some transaction TJ who is also entering into the system, and the timestamp value is, let's say, TJ. So understand now, when the transaction TJ enters after TI, initially transaction TI is in the system with some value, unique value, and TJ is also entered into the system. Remember, timestamp of TI transaction is less than timestamp of TJ transaction. This value will be unique. See, understand one thing. This is just a basic example. You can just think of whenever transaction enters into the system, let's say the transaction entered into the system at 5 p.m. TI is a transaction entered into the system, and let's say transaction timestamp value of TI is your 5. It says that it entered at 5 p.m. Now transaction TJ will enter what? After 5 p.m. Let's say it enters at 6 p.m. So the transaction is 6 p.m. The value given to the TJ transaction as a timestamp is your 6. So we can see that 5 is less than 6. Always remember one thing in this one, and this is very important. It's a kind of opposite way, right? So the thing is, whenever a transaction enters after other transaction, so this transaction value will be greater, right? This transaction value will be greater. And we say that this transaction which entered after TI, for example, TJ, is what your, this is your younger transaction, which entered right now. And this transaction which is already there, this is your older. See, we use the term, you can use older or younger, or you can use this is your senior and this is that junior. Senior transaction means it's already present, right? Before transaction TJ. TJ transaction is junior. Why? Because this transaction has entered after TI. The value is large, but it's junior, right? So we will be using a frequent use of these terms, senior and junior, till your entire end of this topic, right? Remember one thing, the timestamp that they are getting the transaction when they are just about to enter into the system, or say when they entered into the system, whatever timestamp value they have received, or say they are assigned, maybe that's for the system value actually, this value will remain fixed until the transaction exit from the system. This is just like your date of birth, right? So for example, when just born, some date of birth, fixed value, fixed date is given to you, right? So it will not change entire life till you live, right? So in that way, the transaction got the same value, that's what timestamp value. And remember, the order they will be executed, right? For example, TI first entered into the system. First, TI will leave the system, and then TJ will leave the system, right? So the serializability order of transaction, that's timestamp TI less than timestamp of TJ, will be first. TI will run and then TJ. In the same way, TI will exit first and then TJ will exit after TI from the system. This is what timestamp given to the transaction, right? The second is timestamp to data items. Remember, we are not only giving the timestamp to the transaction, also we are giving the your timestamp to the data item. So understand what we have. In this one, we have one is your write timestamp. For example, let's say data item A we will be working on, right? So this is the write transaction A. Remember, this is very important, right? So generally you used to have a lot of problem in this one I have seen. See, write transaction is what actually, it's the largest timestamp of any transaction that executed over write A successfully. Right. So let's understand with the help of an example. For example, I will tell you. Okay, before that, see, over the data item A, we have the second is your read also. Let me just write read timestamp of A. So this data item A, either we have read timestamp or we have write, yes or no. These are the two. Understand these read and write timestamp values, these are not of data item A actually. These are the value they are going to get are the transactions values, transaction timestamp values. Remember, when I say write TS of A, the value which is given to here, for example, if I say on data item A, transaction TI read the value, transaction TI timestamp of TI is continue the previous one is 5. So when this TI transaction will perform the write operation, that is write of A, for example. This TI transaction perform the write operation. Right. So this write operation got the timestamp value, and this write operation, that is write underscore TS of A, for example, the value it will get is 5 now. It means what? See, this is the largest time. For example, largest time means, let's say after this one transaction TJ came, right? So transaction TJ came after this transaction TI, then obviously TJ value of transaction timestamp value will be larger than the TI, right? And that transaction TJ will perform some operation, that is, let's say write of A. So in that case, the value of write timestamp of A will change to that value of the transaction TJ. It means what? Understand, the value to the write timestamp of A does not mean that it was executed at that time. Remember, it doesn't mean that it was executed at that time. Rather, it means that the transaction that performed the write operation on A was entered into the system at that time. Right? So the value which is assigned 5 over here, it means what? The transaction, that is TI transaction, who performed successful write operation on the data item A, was entered at that time, that is 5 p.m. Because the value are assigning to this one is the transaction value, and transaction value is what when it entered into the system. Right? I think it clears. Hopefully, the same goes for your read operation. So for read, if we say read of A, right? So read of A is the largest timestamp. See, focus on the line that I'm saying. Largest timestamp of any transaction. Let me write. Largest timestamp of any transaction that executed read. For example, we talk about the read over. Read of A successfully. See, the largest time says what? The recent one, the right recent transaction that executed this operation. That's the largest time we'll have. We have seen this one, right? The largest time. Largest time stamp of any transaction it can be. See, the time is of any transaction means the value that read of timestamp A is getting is of value of transaction that executed read operation successfully. Understood? So this is what the meaning of, and we provide the timestamp value to the data item as well. And remember one thing, the transaction timestamp of transaction value, right, that the timestamp that we give the transaction will never change throughout their life cycle whenever they will be remain active in the system. But this operation, that's a timestamp value for the data item, their value will keep on changing. So whenever the fresh transaction will come, perform the action with the data item, its value will be of that transaction only, which is the recent or say the largest time. Right? So this is what the two things we have. We talk about providing timestamp to the transactions as well as your data items. I hope you have understood, but our work didn't finish yet. Now we will understand how actually we use these timestamps, right? Okay. So let's see how basically we use this timestamp. Any transaction, see, any transaction can either perform read or write operation that we have seen. Any transaction can perform read and write operation. So we will see what happens when any operation is called out by any transaction. So what I mean to say is, see first, let's say TI is the transaction and it requests for read operation. Let's say a read of A. What will happen in that case? How the read operation? Understand one thing. TI transaction request for read operation. So we will look at the write operation because see, understand, transaction is requesting for read. What is the conflict pair of read? That's what the write. Right. So write operation is the conflict pair. So we will see that. Understand now in this one, if we will see at the transaction timestamp value, if the timestamp of TI is less than transaction timestamp of, let's say, TJ, we have this multiple operations over here, transactions, right? So it means what? Understand, means what? Let me write the statement and we'll understand how the things are working. TI transaction needs to read a value A. It's requesting. See, remember, it's requested. Whether it will be allowed or not, that we will see. This is just a request. So transaction TI needs to read a value, that is capital A. But remember, that was already overwritten. Hence, request will be rejected. Understand now. See, I'm just explaining over here. See, the better way to understand the timestamp is just take the values. We have transaction TI, the timestamp value for TI is, let's say 1. At 1 p.m., transaction TI entered into your system. Now let's say timestamp of some X transaction, we don't know, some X transaction is there who entered after TI transaction, right? So which one? This one is our senior, yes or no? And this is what? Junior, because the value is larger, entered into the system after TI. We have the write operation here, right? So understand, we have the write operation. Transaction TI requested for read of A. Remember, transaction TI is value, when we have the value, this one is less. See, this is 1 and this is 5, isn't it? Right, so we have the write operation in this some transaction and TI request for read. TI request for read. Why we have write? Why we haven't taken read over here? We have seen read and read, no conflict. We will see only conflict pair. If TI is having read, then the other transaction definitely we have the write. So this is what? The value of TI is 1 and the value of TJ is some other transaction, let's say TX over here is 5. Now the value is less over here. It means what? It should be executed first because it entered first into the system. It is senior. But what it means to say is transaction TI wants to read over here. That is what you read of A. The thing is transaction TI should read the value here because it was first executed. Right, and it now it want to read after write operation over here. Right, so what it means, initially when this transaction turn was to perform the read operation, transaction just forget, let's say transaction just forget to read the operation over here. Right, you can say transaction just went out and started watching some movie. When the transaction return TI after return, transaction TX have already performed this operation. And now TI transaction wants to read. It come back and it wants to read now. Right, so we say wants to read. But see, we cannot allow this read operation. Why? Because if we allow this read operation, earlier transaction missed this. And now it want to read. So see, this is, isn't it a conflict pair swap? So if we allow this operation to read after this transaction, it means what? We have allow the conflict pair swapping. So if we allow conflict pair swapping, definitely it will create inconsistency in our database, right? So such type of operations we do not allow. Okay, so it means what? Understand here. Yeah, just change this one. It's not transaction. This is your write. So I told you when we see the read of a transaction EI request for read operation, we'll see at the write timestamp of, let's say, the A data item. So the write timestamp of data item A equals to 5 means what? Already there was a transaction, right? So who performed the write operation on A at, let's say, 5 p.m. example, right? So again, just revising just due to this mistake. So at 5 p.m., some transaction came and they have already performed this write operation. That's what here. And we have the timestamp of TI equals to 1. It means what? Now TI is requesting for this one, request for read operation. So if write is already performed, we'll perform the read operation over here after this one because it's requesting now. But according to the timestamp value of this transaction, we'll see that this operation should already have occurred because this is what? A senior transaction, right? This should have already occurred somewhere before this write operation. And the reason is, might this transaction forget it? And now it wants to what? Read the value of this transaction. So definitely in this case, we will not allow, and this pair will be, rejected. In that case, what will happen? When we'll avoid this conflict pair swap, the transaction as the transaction will say that I have already this value, I'm the senior one, I cannot go back, right? I have to do something. In that case, we will say that you roll back. If you cannot perform, we will not allow you the read operation, right? So you just roll back, right? You go back, take birth again, you can say that become the junior and then execute junior of this transaction who performed this write operation. So hence, in that case, it will roll back or say abort itself and enter into the system again with some new timestamp value, right? So this is the way. This is the way we perform the rejection over here. We will perform reject means we will not allow the TI transaction to perform the read operation in that case. Right, so this is one situation. Other condition is for the same is if our transactions value, for example, is this is less than, we'll see the transaction timestamp value is greater than equal to right timestamp of A. Right, so I hope you have understood this. So what will happen when we have, so we'll understand first greater than and then equal to one by one. Take an example of schedule, let's say TI transaction have timestamp value. Let's take this come at 3 p.m., right? And some transaction TX perform the timestamp value at, let's say, 2 p.m. So this is what senior in this case because value is less, and this is what your junior now, right? So what it means to say this one, this senior operation is there, right? So senior operation means earlier transaction came at 2 p.m. and they performed the write operation on some data item A, for example, right? And now junior transaction comes with larger value and wants to perform what? Requesting for read operation. So that is what read of A. Isn't it should be allowed or not? Definitely in this case, we can allow, there is no problem. This read will be allowed here, right? Why? As the same was, this transaction value is 3, this is greater than 2, 3 is greater than 2. There is nothing wrong, and even this is requesting, this transaction came just right now and requesting to read. This some transaction who have already performed a write operation on the data item A have the timestamp value 2, right? And they have already performed the right operation, so hence this value will be allowed in this case, right? So we can perform this operation over here. Now, what's the condition of equality? So timestamp of your TI transaction is equal to the right operation, right timestamp of it. It means what? We have seen one thing, right? And we already know that, remember one thing, whenever transaction coming into the system, one after other, they cannot have the same value, right? So whenever transaction will come first, will be given a value. And since we have seen the unique values are there, right? So this one already see, this value is your unique, right? You cannot have the same value. But understand here, in this one, we are saying the transaction timestamp of TI is equals to right of TS. Whatever value this is having, the right timestamp also had the value of, will have the value of some transaction TX, right? But when these values are same, what is the possible? Remember, this is the case when the same transaction has just now performed a write operation over here, and now it want to perform the read operation, requesting for read. Means in the same transaction, let's say some TX or TI transaction is there, who perform the write operation A, and right now in the same transaction want to perform the read operation. So definitely there is no conflict. We have already seen the operation in the same transaction have no conflict over here, right? So it's a kind of, the situation is kind of short-term memory loss. For example, we can say that a transaction is requesting for that read, which is already in the same transaction, not from the different one, right? This transaction have just forgot it right now, 1 second before this transaction had performed a write operation on the same data item. Right. So hence the operation will be allowed. But in that case, remember, we need to change the value of your read timestamp. Right. Why? Because we have requested for read and it's allowed now. So this value will change now. And what this value will change is your what? Remember, maximum value, maximum of what? Your previously read timestamp value of A, or we say the timestamp value of TI transaction. So this read TS will get the maximum of previous value, or say the current transactions value, right? So in this way, we understand when we perform the, or say that when we request for some write operation, this is what we have. Remember one thing over here, when TI requested for read operation, I told you, right? We have already seen for a write value, but if TI request for write operation, then the conflict pair comes is your read and write both as well. So in that case, the second is your, when we have TI transaction request for write operation. This is for your read. TI now request for write operation. Let's say write of it. So what we have to take care of now? Understand the first, see, there is a similarity as well as if new thing. Timestamp of TI is, let's say, see again, when we perform the write operation, we have the conflict pair with read and write as well. So first let's see the read. So when its value is less than the timestamp of your A data item, timestamp value of A data item, for example, right? Understand, it means what? The same condition, right? So understand with the help of example, some TI transaction is there having timestamp value, let's say again 5p. Now TX transaction is there whose timestamp value is 10, because see, this is 5 and this is 10, so 5 is less than 10, that's fine, right? So this is, if this is 10, means this is junior and this is what, senior, right? We are requesting for write operation. We have seen the read timestamp value is 10. So that means what? Some read A is already there, right? So read is already performed with some value. And now timestamp TI transaction is having value 5. It means what? Now TI is requesting for write operation. Will obviously be after this one, write of A. But based on the value of the timestamp for this transaction, that is 5, it's senior, means what this transaction was requesting for write operation should have already been executed over this one write off. And now, since when it turns was there, when its turn was there, it forget it. Maybe it went out and went out for a walk, right? And it return came back. Some other transaction had already been their system, performed the read operation, and its value they have already, transaction already assigned to this one. Now, when the TI came back and says that I want to perform this operation, then obviously this is what, it's a conflict pair swap. So this conflict pair we will not allow. And hence this request will be rejected again. We have rejected, why? Because TI should already perform this value. Why? Because it's senior, it came first. But it forget it, went out for work, returned back, transaction TX, some other value, transaction read the value over the read data item A. And now it came back and asking that I want to perform the write action. So we will simply avoid executing this. So in this case, we are going to what, reject the request. The second is, if timestamp of TI value is less than, this was for read, now let's for write. The same situation for write as well, similar one, right? So let's say TI transaction with timestamp value, same example I'm just taking, instead of timestamp value is, let's say 10, 5 and 10 here, 5 less than 10, that's fine. Instead of read operation, we have a write. So let's say write of A. And now timestamp value 5 is there, right? So after this, now TI came and it request for write of A. That is requesting here, its request should come because in the timeline, we have the whole operation after this. But according to the timestamp value, it should be somewhere here before this one. And this must, this is what, forget it. Then definitely when it will ask for this, we will not allow. We will understand that this case is very special. Let me understand. See, this is not allowed. We'll understand this case is very special. And this case is avoided, modified with Thomas. So we'll see after that. But right now, such scenario will again be what, rejected. This will not allow. And say it is rejected. These are the operations which are rejected in this case. So what are the left out operations? If timestamp value of TI is greater than equal to read of timestamp of A. For this write operation. And the other is timestamp TI greater than equal to write of. Remember, for both of the situations, we will simply allow the operation. There will be no problem. So it means what? Understand here, whenever TI is requesting for write operation, we need to take care of read and write both of the operation, right? Here in this case, we have forgotten the transaction, have forgotten the operation and want to execute after this one. So definitely we will avoid this one, we will not allow, because this is a conflict pair swap. It was there, but now it is executing over here, right? So that's why in this scenario, there is nothing wrong. In this one, whenever transaction first is there, now the second is requesting for executing after this. So we will simply allow the permission for this. And equal to condition we have seen means provides the same transaction was there and just forget it, right? And now it wants to execute, so we will simply allow. So these are the timestamp values and these are the operations that we need to take care of, right? So the first one is when TI request for read operation, right? So if the value of transaction is less than the write operation of the, right? So some transaction value, this write operation has the value of the transaction who recently executed, or say the latest in the largest value recently executed the write operation data item A. So transaction is coming with a less value. It means what? It should over be there before this one, but now it's requesting in this one here. Request came here, right? Since it is a conflict pair, we will reject this, will not allow. The same goes here for greater than, right? So greater than means it is requesting after this. So definitely we'll allow that, right? Because it is junior, it is senior. Equal to means within the same transaction, we are going to allow that sort. But the problem, not the problem, but the solution is when we have this scenario, we'll apply the read value. I mean, the maximum value of read timestamp 8 and the timestamp value of TI transaction. In this also, we'll do this one. When both of these are allowed, right? So we will assign the value, which is for the maximum of, you can just think of what should be the value in this case. Whatever value that we have received in this case is your maximum of what? The timestamp of your write. Write timestamp of A. Maximum of your again write timestamp of A and the transaction TI timestamp, that's it. Right. So this write of transaction timestamp of A data item will get the maximum value of this one. Right. So I hope you have understood, and the same goes for here also. We'll need to cover these two things, right? When they have the less values, probably we'll avoid such kind of scenarios. Okay, now let's see what are the properties of timestamp. See, right now we have seen we are avoiding the conflict pair swap. Conflict pair swap, we are avoiding this one, right? So we have seen in conflict serializability, we are not going to swap those operations, instructions which have the conflict pair. So if you are avoid that, definitely we have conflict serializable schedule formation. Right, so we have conflict serializable schedules we will generate in that case. And we have seen if a schedule is conflict serializable, it will also view serializable, because all conflict serializable are also view serializable, we have already seen. Right, but understand one thing, there is a problem of dirty read. Right, see, understand this one. For example, TI transaction and TJ transactions are something like this. And now we have read of A. Let's say commit over here, and this is commit over here. Right. This is what dirty read. We have seen this. Why? Because we have performed the read operation of that transaction which is not committed or at all. Right. Means uncommitted transaction value we are reading, that's your dirty read. So understand one thing, somewhere here in bit one, if it fails, then what will happen? This transaction have already committed, and when it will fail means it will roll back, it will undo the operation, right? So what the problem is, this schedule is your irrecoverable. Means you cannot see this read value will be what? It's a useless. Means that the read operation performed has no existence of this TI transaction edit item. Right. So such type of problems are, you know, are not able to detect in this one timestamp, and we are possibly allowed. So means we have the dirty read problem. We cannot, we didn't talk about who will commit first. The reason is commit operation. Who will commit first? We haven't taken care of this one. We haven't performed the restriction over the commit, even the irrecoverable schedule. And the problem will here goes for the cascading rollback as well. If you have multiple transactions reading values and will roll back this one, then all the transaction will have to be aborted. That's the cascading rollback problem. Right. So this is what dirty read possibility is there in your timestamp. We haven't taken care of that. The second is there will be no deadlock. Remember, Why? If you remember, as a part of your operating system, to have the conditions of a deadlock, we have, I guess, four conditions we used to study. The first is your mutual exclusion, and then we have no preemptions, right? Then hold and wait and circular wait, I guess, right? So understand here, we didn't hold or say we didn't wait for any transaction, right? Because whenever a transaction came into the system, either we allow the transaction or we simply roll back the transaction, right? So we didn't hold any of the operation, or say we didn't hold any of the resource for the transaction. So definitely there is no hold and wait. And if there is no hold and wait, we are not even going to the situation of circular wait as well, because resources are instantly made free when the rollback transactions are operations are being performed. So hence there is no situation of deadlock over here, right? Understand one thing, generally we used to get confused in that one. The second point, another point is your starvation. See, this timestamp may lead to starvation. Starvation means what actually? Let's say a transaction is continuously coming into the system, and every time this transaction is being rolled back. So what will happen is transaction will starve for a long amount of time. Right. So starvation possibility may arise in your timestamp, and due to this, your system will be slow. The transaction will be slower here. Right. Understand the thing is, let's say these are timestamp based. These are the schedules that are generated using timestamp based protocol. Remember, your conflict serializable scheduler here. Means what? Timestamp based protocol is not able to generate all the conflict serializable schedule. But the schedule which are generated by timestamp will be conflict serializable, right? So this is the reason that we generally, are not able to identify all the conflict serializable schedules, right? Okay, so hopefully you have understood what are the properties that we have for timestamp based protocol, right? Now let's see in that important topic we just discussed about Thomas Wright rule. So what is the Thomas Wright rule says over here? And before that, this Thomas Wright rule is used to improve your timestamp protocol, timestamp based protocol. This is just going to improve that, right? So, but remember one thing we'll understand in this one, it generates schedule, it generates those schedule that are view serial, but not conflict serial. This is very different term. We'll understand this, very important, right? So what actually Thomas Wright rule says that if you remember, right, when TI request write operation of on data item A, right, I told you, so what was the situation? If timestamp of TI is less than your what? Write timestamp of A, right? So what we used to do is, let me show you this one here. See this operation, the timestamp of TI is less than your write timestamp of A. So what we did here, in that case, we simply roll back. We ask the TI transaction just to go back. You late, you delayed, now you cannot be allowed to perform the write operation. But what Thomas says that in this case, instead of rollback, you ignore the operation, write operation. So you simply ignore this write operation and you proceed the next of the operation that you have in this transaction. This is what given by the Thomas Wright rule. Okay, understand why we are ignoring and why no, we are not rollbacking. Understand, transaction TI, let's say have timestamp value Continue the same example, 5 and 10 values. Some transaction TX have the 10 value we have seen. So write operation, right? So write of A. Understand now, this transaction is requesting for write operation. It's requesting means it should be here, somewhere it should be here. But since this is what? This is senior because less value. So it should be here somewhere. But now it's requesting for here, now it's present, right? It should be here. So can we allow this request? Understand now. Let's take the values. For example, the data item is your A and have the read of, the 100 value in the database, right? So understand these operation. See, understand this scenario. Are we reading some values in this animal? No. Means what? We are modifying the values without reading. We say this as blind write, you know. This is what blind write. You are simply writing the value. You are not reading the value. You are not dealing with the reading part over here. So understand, if I say the transaction TI also perform the write operation, TI transactions came with the motivation that it will change the data item value to 80 now. And in the same goal, let's say TX transaction is there, who also had the motive to change the value to 40. Why I'm saying that? Because there is no read operation. So then definitely transactions must have some motive. They want to change the values without reading the value. Right. So understand now, first scenario, when we have this operation, we are not having this one. We have this operation. So when we perform this operation, it will take the value A equals to 100 into your local buffer. It will perform the action, means TI will change the value to 80 now. Right. So when we move to this one, this is what again a write operation. So write operation means say what? If the transaction TZ, TX have already decided to change the value of A to 40, irrespective of what value it had before. So A value will come from here, that is from 80, it will change to simple 40. This is the situation when we have this transaction. Now understand that this transaction failed. It means this transaction was delayed. And it will now say that I want to execute over here. Now understand, if this transaction was not executed, so what was the situation? We have only this transaction, right? So let me again write. This is transaction value with 5. So we have write of A. And then says that I want to write of A, perform this write. But before that, let's see what this transaction has done. When there was nothing before this one, then this transaction will take the value A 100 into the database and it will change to what? 40. Because TX transaction is there and it has the goal to set the value 40. Now understand till this point, when the transaction was executed, at this point, this transaction has changed the value to 40. Right. And after this, it will further execute the rest of the instruction of your TI. But if we fail here, we have the transaction, this one, it wants to execute now at this place. But see here, till this, isn't it this transaction also modified the same value which it modified over here? Yes or no? So what we will say is to this operation, we will say to a transaction that you simply ignore this operation. Because if you would have executed before, then definitely there would have no effect on this one, because this transaction is your blind write and it will anyhow change to 40. So there is no use of executing this operation. You simply ignore and execute the rest of the instruction instead of performing the rollback. I hope you understood, right? So it means what? Where there was no effect, if you write operation, the reason only was it was a blind write. Only then we are able to say this thing. Right. So Thomas says that you simply ignore this statement because there is no effect on the value, current value of write operation performed in the different transaction. In the both of the scenario, you won't only change to 40. Right. So there is the thing is it has to be changed to the value 40 if you have ignored or if you right now want to perform the operation. So if TI forget the write operation, then simply we do not execute now. Ignore the operation and execute the rest of the operation instead of rollback. Right. So I hope you have understood this. Right. So see, understand now this Thomas Wright rule. This is a very, you know, unique concept. Let me understand. Let's take the help of example. I told you one statement in the properties. In this one, Thomas Wright rule. This Thomas Wright rule generates schedule which are view serial but not conflict. But what we have understood, any conflict schedule is there, that will also view conflict. These are the Thomas Wright rule is the only rule. Remember, Thomas Wright rule is the only rule in the database that are capable to generate schedules which are not conflict serial but view serial. The reason is the presence of blind write. Right? So let's understand with the help of an example that state this statement. We have T1, T2, and T3 transaction in this way. Some operations are, let's take this operation. Okay. Right, so understand this schedule. Right, we have read operation, then we have transaction T2 write, T1 again write, and are we going to allow this? No, we cannot allow that. Why? Because timestamp says that whenever we have the read operation, okay, fine. Then on the write operation, we have performed the write operation by transaction T2. But again, T1 wants to perform the write operation. We are not going to allow that. But understand one thing. These are what blind write. This is what, isn't it a blind write? After because we are again executing this. And this is also what blind write over here. Means what? Anyhow, if we are not allowed this one, because it entered before initially, this is the senior. And let's say this one value, two value, these are the timestamp values. This is the senior. You should have already executed this, but you are requesting for write operation. No. But see the T3, this is what your junior operation, the last one, right? Now it can perform the write operation. We can allow this one. Right. But instead of performing the rollback, we simply ask this to ignore. Because the next operation is what blind write, and it will simply whether whatever changes you will make in this one, all these changes will gonna vanish anyhow, because this T3 will make its own change. This is the final write. So these changes will be used. So this is the reason that we follow. I hope you have understood. And with this one, we have finished your timestamp based protocol. And probably in the next class, we will start with the next topic, that is log based protocol. So let me know if you have any issue, you haven't understood anything, and we will solve some questions as well, and we will see continue in the next class. So okay.